Jesus. I thank you for this day. I thank you for the grace to stand, Lord, in front of your church, to share with them, to teach them, to do the work you've assigned to me as your servant. I pray, Lord, that in all that I teach, let love be the foundation. And I pray for every person that is in this place today, that we will make a place for your word in our hearts. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I pray that your word will be taught with clarity, your word will be taught in sincerity, and your word will be taught without any sense of falsehood and any sign of manipulation. In the mighty, glorious name of Jesus, as it is a pure word, let it be spoken with purity and out of purity. In the mighty, glorious name of Jesus, I pray, and everyone say, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All right. Last week, I began a teaching titled The Anatomy of Temptation, and I focus on the tempter. Amen. And I'm going to continue today about the tempter again. And I said last week that as believers, we must never entertain any form of ignorance. Ignorance must never be found in us, because sooner or later, we may be casualties, or we may be prey to the devil and miss God's purpose for our lives and those around us, or those that must be affected by the purpose. So just a quick recap from last week. I said the tempter is crafty or skillful or artful. And I said the tempter recognizes God in every temptation. The tempter is knowledgeable and not ignorant. The tempter thrives through doubt. And the things belonging to the tempter, they also have their own glory. Amen. So I want us to continue today, and we are going to go back to Matthew chapter 4. So I'm going to read it and give you some key pointers for our, you know, writing down. Amen.
Amen.
Alright, then from verse 1 it reads as follows. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, "If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the tabernacle, and said unto him, "If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone." Jesus said unto him, "It is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. And when I spoke last week, I also mentioned that you'll see that Satan was able to take Jesus to a couple of places, and those places were not a level, they were higher places. And I warned the church, and I still want to caution the church to say, don't be focused on promotions and upliftment in life. It also matters where it comes from. Don't pursue promotions and upliftment at all cost. And sell your birthright. Amen.
Amen.
Now, today as I continue, you realize that in verse 1 of chapter 4, Matthew, it tells us that the tempter is the devil. It's very important that I mention this as you'll see along. Why am I mentioning that the tempter is the devil? And the word devil is diabolos, which means slander, accuse falsely, or defame. So now, the reason I'm mentioning that the devil is the tempter, I also want you to realize that he's a tempter, and he will use or he will work through human beings, like we see with the Potiphar's wife in Genesis chapter 39, that although the devil is the tempter, when he comes and tempts people, he may, not always the case, but he may tempt you through people. Because you realize that with the Potiphar's wife, as much as the devil is the tempter, he uses the body of, or he uses Potiphar's wife to tempt Joseph. So even if someone comes in your life and the temptation comes through them, they are not the tempter. The devil remains the tempter. It is his occupation. Are you following this?
Amen.
So, because I don't want you to start looking at the people through whom the temptation is coming as the devils, because they are not the devils, but the devil can work through them to tempt you. Hallelujah. And I want you to look at how the devil as the tempter works as in passing. So with Potiphar's wife, you must realize that Joseph was staying in the same house, or was working for Potiphar. And so in other words, they had some form of relationship or closeness. And that's why the devil, who is the tempter, can then work through someone that is close in your life. He doesn't always tempt you through people that are strangers to you. Are you following?
Amen.
Now you look also at Samson, that when Samson fell, the devil tempted Samson through the wife, and there's some form of closeness, there's some form of relationship. Now, throughout history, you will realize that when the tempter, or the devil as the tempter, comes and wants to tempt your life or wants to tempt you, in a negative sense of the word tempt, he will always use someone that you've got a relationship with. He's not going to, or he's hardly going to use strangers. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So please put this in mind to say the tempter is the devil. It's not the person through whom the temptation comes in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And then if you check again, which is very key. In fact, before I touch this one, let me look at this one. In Luke chapter 4, verse 1, it says, Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost. I want you to write that one down. It says, Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost. And then you also look at Mark chapter 1, verse 9. I want you to write these key events down, or these key developments down. It says in Luke 4, 1, Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost. Mark 1, verse 9, it says, was baptized of John in Jordan. So there's events in the life of Jesus, or there's developments in the life of Jesus. And one is that he's now full of the Holy Ghost. And two, he had just been baptized. And then you look at the next one, which is Matthew 4, verse 2, which says, had fasted 40 days and 40 nights. So he was in fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And then we also look at these, you know, developments in the life of the Israelites in Genesis 39, verse 7, which then says, and it came to pass after these things that, okay, first is Joseph in Genesis 39, verse 7. It says, and it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, lie with me. So when you study Genesis 39, you realize that the Bible talks about the favor of the Lord over Joseph's life. And when Potiphar bought Joseph as a slave, he began to, you know, benefit from that favor that God had upon the life of Joseph. Okay? So, and it says, and it came to pass after this thing. So now, listen to this. In Luke 4, 1, it says, Jesus, full of the Holy Ghost. Mark 1, 9, he had been baptized. Not he's going to be baptized. He already has been baptized. And Matthew 4, verse 2, it says, after the 40 days of fasting, 40 days and night of fasting. So there's events that happen. And I want to also, want you to look at Exodus 1, verse 7, which says, and the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceeding mightily, and the land was filled with them. So you look at these events and you realize that the tempter targets believers who are progressing in their walk with God. Now, there are developments in the life of Jesus, and these developments, they attract the tempter in the life of Jesus. There are good developments in the life of Joseph, and those developments, they are bringing temptation in the life of Joseph. There are developments in the life of the Israelites in Exodus 1:7. And as a result of these developments, there is now temptation in the life of the Israelites. So the tempter is always attracted by breakthroughs. The tempter is always attracted by open doors. Every time you progress in life, or every time there's new developments in your life, every time there's breakthroughs in your life, you must understand that with those breakthroughs, then the tempter is on his way.
So
the tempter seldom spends his time on idle believers, as they pose no threat to his kingdom. That's why you will hear believers that when you talk of temptation, they can't relate with you because they don't really get tempted. Because they are idle. There is no movement in their lives. There is no spiritual development. There is no spiritual growth in their life. So Satan does not spend time with those on those people. Because even if they try to say in the name of Jesus, they can't even move the smallest of the demons if there is such.
Because
they are idling.
But
when there's movement, that's where the tempter focuses. Listen to me. If you experience temptation after temptation in your life, it could be that there is movement in your life.
Jesus.
When Jesus, full of the Holy Ghost, baptized, fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and boom, the tempter
comes.
Listen, you know, he's very artful. He's very skillful. Because he doesn't really disturb you or distract you in the process of development. He waits when the process has come to completion and he comes. When things in the life of Joseph are now, you know, flourishing and are now shining and working well, then he comes. When the Israelites have increased, not when they are increasing, when they've increased, he comes. When Jesus had been baptized, when Jesus had fasted, he comes. When you have committed your life to the Lord, he will come. He will not come when you are going to tithe. He will come when you have tithed. Because after tithing, you realize that your things are not working out. He will not disturb you from tithing, but he will deal with you after you have tithed. He will not disturb you when you are going to offer. He will deal with you after you have offered. Because what he tries to do is to move you away from the result or the fruit of what you have done. That's why most people cannot see the fruit of what they have done, not what they are going to do, because the enemy managed to move them. That's why they can complain to say they've been tithing and they've been giving, Jesus, and they've been praying and they can't see results. The reason is he did not stop you from doing those things, but he moved you from your position so that when the fruit comes, it doesn't find you, it finds you misplaced.
Jesus.
He will not move you from your marriage, but he will wait until you are married and he starts to deal with you, not when you are going to.
Jesus.
So you must check here.
that he allows, he waits for Jesus to be baptized. He waits for Jesus to complete his fasting. He waits for the Israelites to increase. He waits for Joseph to be favored by
Potiphar.
And the reason why he sometimes also works this way, he knows that if he manages to get through to you after these things, your fall or the impact of your fall is going to be very great. You remember the young man who the Bible says he was listening to Apostle Paul teach, and the Bible says they were on the third story and he fell asleep on the window from third story and he fell, he died. You ask yourself, why didn't he fall on the ground floor? Why didn't he fall on the first floor? Why didn't he fall on the second floor? He fell from the third floor. Why? Because the enemy, the tempter, wants to make sure that your fall or the impact of your fall is great. He waits for you to be up and he deals with you. He doesn't deal with you when you are still down there. He waits for you to be up and he begins to deal with you. Music team, the reason why there's so much temptations in your life is because you pose a threat to the kingdom of darkness. That's why the enemy will forever be after your lives. If you want to check the most attacked people in the church, it's preachers plus the music team or the worship team. Sometimes I even think pastors are better. But if you look at the music team, you will realize that the enemy is definitely dealing with them and is after them because he understands that they are here and he wants to make sure that their fall or the impact of their fall is great. As a pastor, when you lead a church of 50 members or 100 members, he will find touch you there and there, but he won't really bother much about you. But when your influence as a pastor is now spreading across the communities, now spreading across the towns, across the nations, then you become his focal point. Because he knows that once he has dealt with you, he has dealt with the thousands or the millions of the people that you are influencing. Remember, he is not omnipresent. So, but your influence is, if he deals with you, because of your influence, he has used you to deal with the 10 people that are looking up to you. Are you following me?
Amen.
Right. Then the next thing it says, then the Bible says, then the devil leaveth him. Matthew 4 verse 11. It says, and the devil loved Jesus. And if you look at Luke 4:13, it says, and when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. So listen to me. The tempter will ultimately leave you as he will leave you as temptations. Though they may come as a cycle, they are seasonal. You know, when he starts tempting you, it's like a cycle, because from Jesus he throws three punches. And you will think that, you know, he comes first and you think, no, after a year when I win, he leaves. No, he doesn't leave. He presses you to the verge. He squeezes you to the verge. And some people have given up thinking that he's permanently there. Listen, that tempter is not omnipresent. And he has got a lot of businesses that he must visit. So, because he's not omnipresent, he's definitely going to leave you one day and go and attend others.
Uzo kuyekela ngelinye ilanga abanye sebayekile bayekela ukukholwa bacabanga ukuthi lo mlingisi ohlele empilweni zabo uzohamba.
No, he's not omnipresent.
Akahlala khona.
Because the Bible says he left him. That says when the devil had ended all the temptation. In other words, your temptation will end. But blessed are those who do not end with the temptation. Let me repeat. Blessed are the believers who do not end when their temptation ends. Because we can see that Jesus did not end with the temptation. The temptation ended, but Jesus stood. And he says, he departed from him for a season. Listen, when the devil leaves you, he will always speak in Afrikaans and say, "Ekom terug." Nyabuye, I'm coming back. Because he says he left him for a season. If you study, I think it's Ezekiel chapter 20 or 21, he says, God says, I'm going to remove my sword from my sheath. In other words, there's a time when the sword is in the sheath and there's a time when the sword is out. Because here Jesus was dealing with the enemy, was dealing with the tempter through the sword. The word, it is written. And when the enemy leaves, he puts it back. We put it back, we don't throw the sword away. Because he is coming back. And indeed he did come back, because in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus had an encounter with the tempter again. So I'm saying to you, do not end when your temptation ends. They may be coming one after another, but believe you me that the devil is going to end tempting you. It's seasonal. Those temptations are seasonal. Of course, your season may be 4 months, your season may be 2 weeks, your season may be 3 years, but ultimately, the temptations will end. Can you shout, my temptations will end? Can you shout, my temptations will end? They will definitely end. But they must never end with you.
Jesus.
And we continue, we look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. And it says, for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. So, now, listen to me here. So, Timothy was sent to the believers in Thessalonians. For one reason, to go and check their faith. Because the church was going through various trials. The church was going through temptations. And yet, the Apostle Paul says, we want to check if the tempter has tempted you and our labor not be in vain. So write this one down. The tempter will use your life experiences and of others in particular trying times to move you or cause you to depart from faith through various artistic methods of his. So he is going to use your life experiences and the experiences of others to cause you to depart from faith, or what we call apostasy. He will move you to a place where you fall away. He will move you to a place where now you no longer believe in what you used to believe in. But ultimately, the ultimate goal of the tempter is for believers to fall away, is for believers to abandon the faith, is for believers to really say God does not exist. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I want to show you something as we are about to close. That if the enemy or if the tempter does not succeed, listen, don't allow anything to disturb you now. I want you to listen to this very careful. If the tempter does not succeed to move you away from faith, to cause you to abandon the faith, to cause you to fall away, to cause you to neglect the faith, he's going to do the next thing that I'm going to share with you, which is in Matthew chapter 4, verse
9.
Where it says, after he had taken Jesus to a higher place or a mountain exceeding, he says, and this, and he shows him things, the kingdoms of the world and their glory. He says, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Now, I want you to listen to this. There's life in here. Don't forget what I said last week, that the tempter is artistic. He is very crafty, very skillful. So remember in 1 Thessalonians 3:5, I said his ultimate goal is to get a believer into a state of apostasy, is to get a believer to fall away. If he does not get you to fall away, he will say to you, if you bow down and worship me. Last week I covered that, yes, he is able to give you things, but today I want you to focus on this. I hope you are hearing this. He says, if you fall down and worship me. Pastor, are you hearing this? He says, if you fall down and worship me. The tempter is not saying to Jesus, leave your God and worship me. He is not saying that. He is not saying to Jesus, burn your bridges with God. He is not saying to Jesus, neglect God. He says to Jesus, if you will fall down and worship me. What is the tempter here doing? I said earlier on that if he does not manage to cause you to fall away, he is going to get you into a state of worshiping him and God at the same time. Let me repeat it. The enemy or the tempter, if he fails to get you to move away from God, if the tempter fails to cause you to abandon your faith, if the tempter fails to move you away from the things of God, his next stop or his next method is that he is going to get you into a place of mixture. He is going to get you into a place of double life. Your one leg is this side, your other leg is this side. He is going to get you into a place where you do not only worship God, but you also worship Him. And you must understand that when the tempter comes, he does not deny the existence of God. Because he knows that you believe that God exists. However, he will persuade you to a life of double standards.
Jesus.
A life of mixture. If he can't get you out of your faith, he will get you to a place where you do ancestral rituals and you still pray. That's what he does. He is not a fool. He knows that if he tells you to leave God, you may refuse, but he will want to share you with God. That's why the Bible says he is a jealous God when he talks about our God, because he does not want to share us with any other person. That's why even people who commit adultery, they will not force you to divorce. They will rather say, let's settle for sharing. Because they know you may refuse to divorce, but you may not refuse to share. This is the method of the tempter in our times. This is where the tempter is affecting the church. He can't get the church to move away completely from God. But he will opt for sharing. Sunday you can worship God, but Saturday worship me. You can pray, but you can also do imipaso. You can worship, but still fornicate. Because I cannot stop you from singing in church. But at least I can share you with the sin. At least I can share you with your God. I know he is a jealous God. And you are using him as a safety net. It's fine, don't leave him. It's fine, don't stop going to church. It's fine, don't stop praying. It's fine, don't stop studying the Bible. But I want to share you with your God. This is what the tempter was doing with Jesus. I can't get you away from your God. But I want you to accommodate me in your life. I want to be part of your life. Make some space for me. You are married, yes. But when I send you a text and I say I love you, just respond and say I love you too. I can't get you to divorce, but have some time for me. Have some space for me. Let's have some quality time together. You can be with your husband, but also have some time with me. You can have time with God as your husband. But I also want to be your husband. Worship me and your God. I'm not asking you to stop, but I'm saying worship me too, because I will also be able to fulfill you. I will also be able to satisfy you, because I also have ownership of what I have just shown you now. I also have some authority. I am not a fool. I am not poor. You belong to me as well. God will satisfy you. I will also satisfy you. That's how the tempter works.
Jesus.
That's why we have believers. Your one leg is in God and your other leg is in the world. There's so much mixer. There's so much mixer. You are lukewarm. We are even confused. We don't know whether you are still born again or not. Because 1 minute you are praying and crying. The other minute you are full-time gossiping. 1 minute you are praying in tongues. And the next minute you are cursing people. Your one leg is this side, you know, your other leg is this side. That's why Jesus says, you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve God and mammon. He is talking about money. But what Jesus is understanding here is that, listen, when the enemy cannot afford to cause you to move away from God, he will want you to serve him and God.
Jesus.
We have believers that want best of both. They want best of God and they want best of the devil, the tempter. How many believers have received what is coming from the enemy? They are promoted, but there was some sexual immorality before promotion. How many believers have received from the enemy? They are employed, but there was money paid for the employment opportunity to be opened. How many believers are married? And married to a person they forced out of marriage.
Jesus.
And you have me as a pastor who comes and say, let those that God has joined together, let no man put asunder. There's no God who has joined these people together. Because this person had put asunder and is now joining. Best of both. We live in a time, if it's not a time of apostasy, it's a time of mixture. What we call polytheism, which means worship of many gods. There are believers who are worshiping God, but gods as well. Your marriage has become another god in your life. The things that God has given you or allowed you to acquire in life, they have now become God in your life. The tempter knows you love God. And he equally knows that you can love him too.
Jesus.
And Jesus here says that you shall worship no other god. Jesus is not denying that there are other gods. He is saying, out of the many gods that may be existing, only this one is the one that must be worshipped, because he is jealous. Let's stand with our feet.
Jesus.
The tempter will try to get you to abandon your faith. And the difficulty with this is, some of you grew up in church. It's difficult for you to spend a Sunday without going to church. So he will not even attempt to get you out of church. But he will get you to sit in church with him. Or when you come to church, he will say to you, hey, I won't go in. Let me rather wait for you here at the gate. Or you can go to church. When you come back, you'll find me home. And indeed, you leave him at home or you leave him at the gate. When you are here, you are very holy. You love God. You are very sensitive to the move of the Holy Ghost. You love people. You are a worshiper. You pray in tongues. You do all these things. You are committed. But when you leave the gate, then you leave the other God and you get hold of another God.
Ngempela ungatholakala sowudumisa wenza konke ngoba vele uSathane wakho kulinde ngaphandle kodwa uma uphuma uyohlangabezana naye.
The devil doesn't have a problem sharing you with God.
Sathana kanankinga nokukushera noNkulunkulu.
But God has a big problem sharing you with another God.
Kodwa uNkulunkulu unenkinga yokukushera nomunye uNkulunkulu.
Listen to me. God, the only true living God, has a serious issue when you serve other gods.
uNkulunkulu yena yedwa lo phila esimkhonzayo unenkinga uma ngabe uzokhonza abanye uNkulunkulu.
I'm so certain that there are still believers who defend corruption.
Ngiyamangala ukuthi kunamakholwa asa defenda icorruption.
Because the tempter,
ngoba lo olingayo,
has said to them,
uthe kubo,
you can go that side. When you are done, you can also come to me.
Jesus.
Apostasy.
The apostasy.
And polytheism.
The polytheism.
Move away from faith. Or worship many gods. This is how the tempter works. He's artful. He's shrewd. He's crafty. He's skillful. He will not scare you. He will not shock you. He will silently work in you and through you. And that when you try to lift up your head, you realize, oh, this guy has really affected me. I see you are in church. And I'm sure there's other churches that are on now. And they are possibly full if it's not in South Africa. But if in South Africa, for sure there are 100 or there are 250 if they are outside. That's good. But how many of us and how many of those people have one leg this side and the other leg this side? They are worshipping Satan for what is giving them. And they are also worshipping God for what is giving them. How many of us are living a life of mixture? The reason why the Lord has not really dealt with you according to our mixture is because He is long-suffering and does not want any person to perish. But he wants us to repent. I want to call people today to a place of repentance. Even those that are watching the YouTube video, I want to call you to a place of repentance. Yes, we celebrate that the enemy did not manage to get you out of church. The enemy has not managed to stop you from praying. He has not stopped you from reading the Bible. He has not stopped you from tithing and giving. But he has gotten you to a place of mixture. He has gotten you to a place of double or dual citizenship. You are part of his kingdom, you are also part of the kingdom of God. He has gotten you to a place of double life. A believer, a non-believer at the same time, a paradox.
Jesus.
Place of mixture. How many of us are living double lives? I'm not here to condemn you, but I'm here to share with you. Because God has not destroyed any of us. And he does not desire to destroy us. But his desire is for us to worship him and him alone. But you are here. You know deep down in your heart, you are living double life. I want to pray with you today. I want you to run to the front. I'm not going to ask you what you are doing in your life. All I'm going to do is to cry out with you in repentance. And I believe today we can fully return to him. I don't want to waste time. If you know you are living double life, you know, yes, apostasy is not there, but there's polytheism. You are worshipping God and other things. And when I say worshipping other things, I'm not saying literally going down, but you are living a double life. A life of continuous sin and a life of righteousness. I don't know how it mixes, but we are able to do that. I invite you today to run to the front. And I want to pray with you. You can choose to harden your heart. And you can choose to allow God to speak to you. And say, Lord, today I choose to worship you and you alone. I choose to have my two legs at one place. Not one on the left and not one on the right. I choose to live for you. If you are here, come, let me pray with you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus,
yes, Lord,
I thank you, Lord, today for your word.
Thank you, Jesus.
Your word indeed is living. Your word indeed is active. Your word is indeed sharper than a two-edged sword. Your word indeed will never return to you void, Lord, or empty without accomplishing that which you have sent it out for. Father, many of us, the tempter has not managed or he has failed to get us out of church. He has failed to get us out of Bible study. He has failed to get us out of prayer. He has failed to get us out of offering and tithing. But he has won in getting us to a place of mixture. Many of us are living double standard lives. Many of us are living two lives. Many of us are accommodating righteousness and wickedness same in ourselves. Many of us are worshiping you, but are also worshiping other gods. This is where the enemy, this is where the tempter, this is where the devil wanted us to be. And many of us are in that place. And I pray to you today, Father, that may those that are repenting find comfort in repentance. May those that are repenting be strengthened, Lord, even as they choose you over what the enemy, over what the tempter promises to give to them. In the mighty name of Jesus. And I pray, holy and righteous Father, that in this message and with this message, may the eyes of our understanding be enlightened. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. May you lead your children, Lord, to a place of holiness where we are separate and separate for you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, deliver us from a place of mixture, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you that you have not dealt with us according to our wickedness. You have not dealt with us according to our corrupt ways. You have not dealt with us according to our double lives. But you have dealt with us for the sake of your righteous and holy name, the name above all name. In the name of Jesus, forgive us, Lord, for double life. Forgive us, Lord, for polytheism. In the name of Jesus, we sincerely repent, Lord, and we receive your mercy. We receive your grace, and we receive your forgiveness, and we receive the comfort of the Holy Ghost. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. We worship you and honor you. In Jesus' name, everyone say amen.